الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده ولي الصالحين وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وحبيبه وبعد اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا واجعلنا من عبادك المخلصين اللهم استخلفنا لنصرة هذا الدين اللهم أفردنا لما خلقتنا له ولا تشغلنا بما تكفلت لنا به اللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا ولكل من له حق علينا ولمشايخنا وأساتذتنا يا أرحم الراحمين Oh Allah, we ask you to forgive our sins, to bless our deeds, to direct us to the goodness in this dunya, so we be righteous and do the righteous deeds. Inshallah, we meet Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Akhirah. We ask you to protect us from ourselves, from our desires and temptations that take us away from your way. We ask you to protect us from the shaitan, and we ask you to help us, showing us the way to you so we know you and we worship you the way you want. Oh Allah, we ask you to bless our gathering, bless our families, our friends, and to bless the whole Muslim ummah around the world, inshallah. And let them follow the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam 40 steps to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to watch themselves. So inshallah they come close from the right way of Allah. قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ أَنَا وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِي. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling him in the Quran to say this is my way. I call for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, well, I call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on basira, on ilm. Me and whoever will follow me. So the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the right way. The sabil to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the sabil of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made it clear, and he clarified everything before he died sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him in the Quran, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. And this ayah was revealed in الحجة الوداع, the farewell hajj. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Muhammad, today I completed your deen to you and I perfected my ni'mah on you and I am pleased with Islam to be your deen, your religion. So alhamdulillah rabbil alameen for ni'matul Islam, and it is a big ni'mah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon us. We ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala day and night to accept our deeds and to forgive our sins and to help us inshallah to be good and righteous Muslims. Ameen, ameen. So one of the lessons that we should learn as Muslims is the lesson of muraqabah, the one we talked about today in Jum'ah. We have to know what does it mean by muraqabah, watchfulness, where does it come from, and when it comes into an Islamic context, what is the real meaning of watchfulness? If we go to the Quran and we navigate the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala In many ayat, subhanahu wa ta'ala is explaining the muraqabah. Muraqabah in Arabic, to watch. If somebody is watching something, we say yuraqibu or turaqibu. He or she is watching someone or something. And when it comes into the Islamic context, Al-Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah, one of the sheikhs of Islam, Ibn Al-Qayyim, he says المراقبه watchfulness is دوام علم العبد وتيقنه باطلاع الله عليه ظاهرا وباطنا دوام علم العبد the continuous knowledge of the servant and certainty that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching over him in public and in secret, secretly and publicly. When the servant comes to the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is watching over him, wherever he or she goes, in whatever he or she does, this is muraqabah, this is watchfulness. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called himself Ar-Raqib, the one who is watching, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Raqib is one of Allah's names. And also Al-Hafiz, the one who keeps, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also Al-Shaheed, the one who witnesses, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many names of Allah's name, they come to the conclusion that he, subhanahu wa ta'ala, knows each and everything that we do and we leave. And he, subhanahu wa ta'ala, is watching over us. And then, he, subhanahu wa ta'ala, says in the Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَخْفَى عَلَيْهِ شَيْءٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي السَّمَاءِ. Surely, there is nothing hidden for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the heavens and on earth. Nothing is hidden. He subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. And he subhanahu wa ta'ala is with you wherever you are. This is also another ayah that gets us the idea that he subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching all the time. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَعْلَمُ خَائِنَةَ الْأَعْيُنِ وَمَا تُخْفِ الصُّدُورِ. He subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what your eyes are looking to, and he knows what the chests will conceal. Whatever is concealed, hidden inside of your chest, you did not even think about it, and you did not tell anyone about it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that. وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ فَاحْذَرُوهُ. And know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows whatever in yourselves. So beware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Beware of the wrath and the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we always say, the muraqabah, watchfulness from us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to see us where He likes to see us. In the masjid, in the majalis al-ilm, in the lectures, in good places. So we should be there. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala finds you wherever He wants to find you, and loses you wherever He wants to lose you. If we go the opposite, if we go to places that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want us to be there, and He subhanahu wa ta'ala misses us in the masajid and in the good gatherings, we will not be watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in what we do and what we leave. And we will be on danger if we do so. So He subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knows what is in ourselves. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ رَقِيبًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching over everything. He knows everything, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also in Surah Al-Alaq, اقرأ, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the kuffar and what they do to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has given da'wah, and they are always against him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they call him names sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they call him magician and poet and many things. And then they don't go back, they don't quit. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to them in Surah Al-Alaq in one ayah and saying, أَلَمْ يَعْلَمْ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ يَرَى. Didn't he know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can see? أَلَمْ يَعْلَمْ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ يَرَى. Didn't he know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can see? And then later Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving them the adhab. كَلَّا لَإِنْ لَمْ يَنْتَهِ لَنَسْفَعًا بِالنَّاصِيَةِ نَاصِيَةٍ كَاذِبَةٍ خَاطِئَةٍ فَلْيَدْعُ نَادِيَهُ سَنَدْعُ الزَّبَانِيَةَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that this man who is opposing you, Muhammad, he doesn't know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can see him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching over him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is capable of taking him to the fire. And he is boasting and making himself proud of the people around him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is capable to take all these people to the Jahannam. So, أَلَمْ يَعْلَمْ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ يَرَى. Doesn't he know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can see? So this is also another ayah that gets us the idea that He subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching over us. Many ayat in the Quran that explain how well Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the small things before the big ones. Things that we don't even know before we know of, He subhanahu wa ta'ala knows of these things. And what we do, He subhanahu wa ta'ala is well aware and watching, and He knows subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then if we go to the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to see the quality of watchfulness, and how did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam explain to the Sahaba radhiyallahu alayhim how to be watchful over the deed, how to calculate everything you do and to see if it is good, you do it, and if it is bad, you quit and you don't do it. And one of the great hadiths, even if you open the Sahih al-Imam al-Nawawi in his book Riyad al-Salihin, the chapter of watchfulness, al-Muraqabah, he starts with this hadith, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, with Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, narrating the hadith of Jibreel alayhi salam coming to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, asking him about Islam, Iman, and Ihsan. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explains Islam and Iman and Ihsan, and in Ihsan, he says to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as if you see Him, and if you don't see Him, He subhanahu wa ta'ala is seeing you. So the ulama say there are two levels of muraqabah in this hadith. To worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as if you see Him, this is the highest level. So you come to the salah, you start the salah, you say Allahu Akbar, you mean it. Sometimes we just say Allahu Akbar and our body is here in the masjid and our mind is totally away. Sometimes even it's around the globe in Egypt or Pakistan or India, it's not just here in Canada, it goes away. So when we say Allahu Akbar, if we are watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we mean what we say, Allahu Akbar, He is the most great, the greatest. So He is greatest than myself, my family, my wife, my car, my house, my family back home, everything. So when I say Allahu Akbar, if I mean it, I will have the sweetness of Iman inside of my heart. When I read Al-Fatiha, I will listen to myself or to the Imam, so I know what is the meaning of Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawm al-Din. We will know these things. So when Jibreel is telling the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to worship Allah as if you see Him, this is the highest level. So whatever I come to do, the ulama say it is better always to calculate before you start doing something. If you want to do anything, just think about it before you do it. Don't do it and then you think it is good or bad. Think before. Even if it is just a short time, think about it. Is this work that I am going to do, is this business I am going to do, will be beneficial for me in this life and afterlife, or just in this life, or it's just about the afterlife, or it is none of all these. It is just for this dunya and my desires and temptations. Like, that's why Al-Hasan Al-Basri, rahimahullah, one of the great scholars of Islam, Imam Al-Hasan Al-Basri, he always say, whenever you come to do something, take some time before you do it and think about it. If it is something to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't hesitate to do it. And if it is something that will displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you never do it. If you just take a moment before you do it, then you are watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a meaning, one of the meanings of watchfulness. And then this is the highest meaning, to work and walk and sleep and do everything as if you see Allah in front of you. That's why one of the scholars, one day he came to some people and they were talking about someone. They were talking about the governor or the president or the queen or the king, as we do nowadays. We are all politicians. When it comes to politics, everybody is just saying whatever he or she thinks, and he or she will be defending his opinion as it is the only good one. And then the scholar, he entered and they were talking about the hakim, the ruler. And then he asked them, are you going to talk about him this way if he is here? They say, no, we are not going to say this in front of him. So he told them, so he is already here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is here and watching and listening to you. So you never say anything about anyone who is not there. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always there. So if you say something about someone, He's watching and recording subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whatever you hate, don't say it. Keep it to yourself and think about it. Because if you are not getting hasanat, you are losing hasanat and gaining sayyat. So this is also the highest level of watchfulness, to worship Allah as if you see Him. And the other side of the hadith, if you don't see Him, He subhanahu wa ta'ala is seeing you. And this is the lower level. The lower level. Because He subhanahu wa ta'ala is already seeing us. And we know this. If we do not believe in this, that He subhanahu wa ta'ala is seeing us, we are negating one of His asma and sifat, sami' and alim and khabir, and this will be kufr, wal'iyadhu billah. But if we know and believe that He subhanahu wa ta'ala is seeing us, so we should be careful of what we say, what we do. So this is the level of muraqabah that some of the ulama said in the hadith. The first one, the highest one, to worship Him subhanahu wa ta'ala as if you see Him. And the second one, if you cannot do that, He subhanahu wa ta'ala is always seeing you and me. So we should be watchful of what we do. And another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us about hadith sahih, hadith, very famous hadith, hadith al-sab'ah, the seven categories of people who will go to Jannah, and they will be shaded under the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, the shade of the throne, arsh, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know the critical day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, that day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be angry, that day, and the sun will be closed from the people, and everybody will be sweating, and the people will go to Adam alayhi salam and say, Adam, you are the first of the creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala favored you and created you with His own hands. He subhanahu wa ta'ala made the angels to prostrate for you. He subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you from His spirit. He subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you the knowledge of all things and all the names. So please intercede for us so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can help us today, which is the day of Yawm al-Qiyam. And the hadith is sahih. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us on that day, people will go and they go first to Adam and they tell him this. And Adam alayhi salam will say, I see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my Lord. He is very angry that I have never seen Him angry as today. I cannot go. And they will go to Nuh alayhi salam and all the prophets Musa and Isa until they come to our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we know, he is given the shafa'ah, the intercession. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will go and prostrate under the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive his people, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept the shafa'ah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be included in Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam shafa'ah. If we are included in that shafa'ah, we are saved that day. So during that day, and everybody is thinking, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says like one image, one scene of that day, يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ. Why? لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مِّنْهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ شَأْنٌ يُغْنِيهِ. That day, the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, everybody will be fleeing from his brother, his sister, his family, his wife. Everybody is just saying myself, myself, myself. Why? Because everybody is asking the same question. I need some hasanat. Can you please give me some hasanat? So the father will ask the daughter and the son will ask the father and the mother. And everybody will say, I have the same question. I have the same disease that you have. And I am asking the same remedy that you are asking. And I need more good deeds to be put on the scale so I can be saved that day. So يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ. Everybody is fleeing from his family. وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ. لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مِّنْهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ شَأْنٌ يُغْنِيهِ. That day everybody has his own business to mind, which is the business of hasanat and sayyat. It is not the business of this life. It is the business of hasanat and sayyat. The currency that day is good deeds and bad ones. So that's why those seven categories who will be saved that day and shaded on the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we look and examine each one of them, they are all watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in whatever they do. The first of them is Al-Imam Al-Adil, the just ruler, a president, a governor, a manager, Even me and you at home, we are rulers in our family, in a small size. Al-Imam al-Adil, the Imam who is just. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me a position, I am just between my employees, my people, my community. So I never favor someone because he is my relative or he is my close friend to some other people who have more qualities, but they don't have relationship with me, which we all fall in nowadays and we see around us. Favoritism is big thing today. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, this is from his prophecy sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He told the Sahaba radhiyallahu alayhim that favoritism will be after me and people will favor each other. So you be careful and you watch Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the first one is al-Imam al-Adil. The second one, وشاب نشأ في عبادة ربه. A young man who has been raised up in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala worship. He's worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala since he was young. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed him to come up in a good Muslim family between two good righteous parents, and then he is picking up and he's taking Quran and Hadith and Sunnah, and he is trying to do as much as he can to be a good Muslim. A shab, young man or woman, nasha fi ibadatillah. So he has been worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala since he was young, and he continues and he dies on that. He will be shaded on that chair on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah. ورجل قلبه معلق بالمساجد. A man that his heart is always connected to the masajid. What does this mean? It means that some people, we see these people, when the masjid is there, they go before the salah, have an hour before the salah, especially salatul fajr. And they go and they make some salah and they open the mushaf and they read for minutes and hours sometimes. And they love to stay in the masjid the whole time. They don't have to be retired people or elders. Sometimes these people are young people. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put the love of the masjid inside of their hearts, and they like to stay in the masjid the whole time. When they leave from the masjid, they take every chance to come back to the masjid. So even before the salah, if somebody is saying we can go to the masjid to do something, he or she will be the first to go to the masjid. He's always thinking about the masjid, going to the masjid, coming from the masjid. When you ask about him or her, he is in the masjid, she is in the masjid. So this is the one who loves the masjid. So his qalb, his heart, is always connected with the masjid, and he loves the masjid. So he will be shaded on the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah. And also, وَرَجُلٌ دَعَتْهُ امْرَأَةٌ ذَاتُ مَنْصِبٍ وَجَمَالٍ فَقَالَ إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهِ. A man that a young and rich and beautiful woman called him for the fahisha, and he can do it, and he said, I fear Allah. A man who's called by a young and beautiful woman for fahisha, to do something in haram, and he said, I fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this dunya. He did not transgress against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this dunya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make sure that he is satisfied and pleased on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, and he will shade him under the shade of Arsh al-Rahman. And also, وَرَجُلٌ ذَكَرَ اللَّهَ خَالِيًا فَفَاضَتْ عَيْنَاهُ. And a man who remembered Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and then his eyes get some tears. He is remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Nobody is around him or him, and he is making salah or dhikr or reading Quran, and his heart starting to tremble, and he started getting some tears, thinking about the day after, thinking about his life. And nobody is around him. He's just between himself and Allah. He's alone. So he remembered Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he is crying. Another man, the one who رجل صدق بصدقة فأخفاها حتى لا تعلم شماله ما أنفقت يمينه. A man who gave a charity and he hides it to the extent that his left hand does not even know how much his right hand has given. Some of us, when we give a charity to the masjid or to the poor, we try to calculate it many times. But some other people, they just give. They don't care how much they are giving because they know the equation. They are smart Muslims. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you double and triple and more, subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you give, He subhanahu wa ta'ala gives more. So they don't even count how much they give for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if we study these seven categories, al-imam al-adil, shabun nasha fi ibadat rabbi, rajulani, we miss one. ورجلان تحابا في الله اجتمع عليه وتفرق عليه. Two people who love themselves just for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When they meet just for Allah. When they leave on the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prescribed. They love themselves just for Allah. They don't work with each other. They don't have the same status at work. They just love each other for Allah's sake. They will be also saved that day. ورجلان تحابا في الله اجتمع عليه وتفرق عليه. ورجل قلبه معلق بالمساجد ورجل دعته امرأة ذات منصب وجمال فقال إني أخاف الله ورجل تصدق بصدقة فأخفاها حتى لا تعلم شماله ما أنفقت يمينه ورجل ذكر الله خاليا ففض عينه. These seven categories, they are all watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The just ruler, he is watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he is just, like Umar radiallahu anhu. He was just and Faruq at his time radiallahu anhu. So he was watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know many stories about Umar radiallahu anhu, that he was digging a grave for himself while he's alive. He prepared his grave long time before he dies. And he goes to the grave and he closes the doors and he keeps weeping and weeping and weeping. And then sometimes he fainted while weeping. And when people see him in the morning, they see two black lines in his cheeks. Umar radiallahu anhu. Umar. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, if the shaitan sees you, Umar, he will take another way. The one who is the criterion between right and wrong, Umar radiallahu anhu. They were given the glad tidings of Jannah, that they are going to Jannah. However, they are still watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he will be crying for what he has done before Islam. And he will say, oh Allah, I wish that the mother of Umar hasn't even given birth to Umar. I wish that I didn't even come to this life. And who is him? Umar radiallahu anhu. So a just ruler, he's watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm not watching my employees, I'm not watching my wife and children, I'm not watching the people I work for, I watch Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Shabun nasha fi ibadat rabbi, young man who is just getting up in Islam and he is taking the right way. He can take the other way, and it's easy, especially nowadays in the West, in North America, and here in Canada. Young Muslims, they can get deviated very easily away from the road of Islam. We have everything available outside. If you just wish, you find whatever you wish. But he is still coming to the masjid, coming to the halaqat, reading the Quran, and he is getting raised up in the state of Islam. And he meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that. And we know that he has some desires that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put inside of us as humans, but he did not fulfill his desires in haram. And it was hard and difficult, but he did not do anything haram. A young man or a young woman doing this, they have to be shared by the share of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They did this out of watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then two men who love each other just for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are also watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't ask each other some favors and some things to be done. And if you don't give me the favor, I don't call you the next day and I take your number off and I don't know you when I meet you next time. I don't say salam. This is not the way that the Muslims should be. Unfortunately, we have some Muslims this way. If you are of some benefit to him, he will keep calling you day and night and calling you my brother, you are my brother and you are this. And also sisters will be the same. But if the business is gone and there is no favors coming from you, he will never pick the phone up for months and even years and asks about you. Because this is the shaitan way, this is just the dunya business. So those people who love each other just for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they watch themselves and they watch Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that man who loves the masjid, he can pray at home, or he can pray at work. He can spend his time with his children. And instead of reading Quran for hours in masjid, he can go and take his family out as we do, and he do this. But he is favoring Allah, and he is sitting with Allah in the masjid, in the company of the angels, reading Quran, making dhikr, doing something good, because he's watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the one who is given sadaqah, and he doesn't count, he's watching over himself and watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he knows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him back. And he knows that the one who owns this life is Allah. And the one who owns my money, my car, my house, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't own anything. When I die, I have nothing. The real owner is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the one that a young and beautiful woman is calling him to do fahisha, to do something in haram, and everything is there, and the means are there, and the road is paved, and the doors are open, and nothing is against it, and he doesn't do it, this is not easy for us to do as humans. If we do this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not let us down. And he subhanahu wa ta'ala, as if we, when we watch him subhanahu wa ta'ala here, he will watch over us and take care of us in here and in the afterlife. So we will be shaded under the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the one who mentioned Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and remembers him alone, and then he is crying and he is weeping, also he is watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's not watching anyone. Sometimes we cry and weep in the gathering of people, in Salatul Jama'ah, in Taraweeh, in Ramadan. But when you just are alone and you weep and you cry because you think about your sins and you think about this dunya and akhirah and what you did and what you should have done, and then you cry, he or she is watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So all these seven categories are watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they are taking the means to him subhanahu wa ta'ala to do whatever they can to come closer from him subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the hadith of Shaba is a famous hadith. The seven categories, we should memorize these seven categories. So we should be at least one category, if not two or three. So a just ruler, a young man who has been raised in Islam and he is doing good, two men, when we say two men or a man, it always means man or woman. This is in Arabic. When we say rajul, it means rajul or imra'a. So two men or two women who love each other just for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the same will be if a man, young woman calling him for fahisha, will be the same. A woman that a man is calling her for fahisha and she refuses, she will be at the same situation. And the one who gives will be a man or a woman also. And also the one who remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and weeps and cries, this also can be a man or a woman. And the man and the woman whose heart is also connected to the masjid can be a man or a woman. So the categories are not just men and women. So these seven categories, inshallah, try to think about it and try to be at least one of them to reach the limit or to reach the status of being shared on that day of Yawm al-Qiyamah under the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many hadith the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has given us about watchfulness and being watchful over our deeds. One of them, hadith Mu'ad radiallahu anhu. One day, as we know, Mu'adh, he narrated many hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One day he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "O Prophet of Allah, advise me, give me a piece of advice." So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, "Mu'adh, worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as if you see him. U'budullah ka'annaka tara." Worship Allah as if you see him. Very short statement and advice from the Prophet to Mu'adh radiallahu anhu. Another hadith, we know that this hadith is major and it changes many things about what we think about the people that we see in a good way and they end up in another way. But it's a hadith about the three categories who will be going to the fire of hell on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah. The first three categories of Muslims who will go to fire of hell on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, the first one will be a alim, a scholar. A alim who is given ilm. Second one, one who is given charity. The third one is somebody who died fighting for the cause of Allah, mujahid fi sabilillah. This hadith is great and big. A alim who knows the Quran and the Sunnah will go to the fire first. Why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will question him on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah. I gave you ilm. What did you do with ilm I gave you? He would say, oh Allah, I learned the ilm and I was teaching for the sake. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, you lie. You were learning and teaching to be said, MashaAllah, he's a alim. He's a scholar. And it was said in dunya, you go to the fire. The second one, the mutasaddiq. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him, what did you do with the money I gave you, the wealth I gave you in dunya? He said, Allah, I gave to the people, to the poor, right and left, secretly and openly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, you lie. You have given in dunya to be said, MashaAllah, he is a mutasaddiq, he is generous. And it was said in dunya, you go to the fire. And the last one, the mujahid fi sabilillah, the one who is fighting in the cause of Allah. And then Allah will ask him, I gave you the chance to die in the battle and to be in the battle against the enemies of Allah. What did you do? He said, oh Allah, I was fighting, so your name will be there and for the victory of Islam. He said, you are lying. You are just fighting to be said, MashaAllah, he is brave. And it was said in dunya, and he goes to the fire. Why are these people going to the fire? They did not watch Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in what he has given them. The first one, he was given ilm, and he didn't watch Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his ilm. Second one, he was given money, he didn't watch Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his money. The third one was given the ability and the capability to go for jihad, and he did not watch Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They all, their niyyah was just for this dunya, and they have gotten what they have intended in this life. And when we come to be watchful, how to do it? Some of the ulama, they prescribe and say, watchfulness is something that's not easy, but there are some ways that we can achieve that. The first one is to know the meaning of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Raqib, the watchful, Al-Hafiz, the one who keeps everything, and Al-Shaheed, the one who witnesses subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we study the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then we know the meanings of these names. This is the first step on the way of watchfulness. If we don't know the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we don't know the real meanings, we will not achieve the level of watchfulness that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking for. And also, to achieve the level of ihsan, which was described in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to worship Allah as if we see him. If we don't see him, he is seeing us. So we have to achieve also that level to reach watchfulness. And also to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a lot with our tongues and also in our hearts. Remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you remember him, he subhanahu wa ta'ala remembers you. فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. Remember me, I will remember you. When you are remembering him subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are in the company of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you are in the company of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you shouldn't be afraid of anyone. If you have Allah on your side, you don't lose anyone. Even if the all means of this life are away from you, and you have Allah, you have everything. But if you lose Allah, and you have all the means in this life, you don't have anything. So dhikrullah is very important, to have khashya from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also another way to get ourselves accountable of what we do. Think about what we did. Every time, every day, every night we come to sleep, then we come, when we put our heads on the pillow, we just think for a few minutes, what did I do since I wake up in the morning until I come to bed? In the morning, I pray my fajr, alhamdulillah, I say alhamdulillah, okay. I didn't pray my fajr, I prayed after sun shine, okay, this is wrong. So I make istighfar, oh Allah, please accept my salah and accept my deed, inshallah, I will do better, inshallah, tomorrow. Okay, I went to work, did I say anything bad about anyone? Did I backbite anyone? Yes, I did. Oh, I remember I was sitting in the office today and somebody came, asked about someone and was doing, I told him something bad about him. So this is bad. Oh Allah, please forgive me. Oh, Alhamdulillah, we did something good today. We read some Quran. We talk about some good things. We say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. So you just get a pen and paper and write it down. If you don't want to, just think about it, because it is already written. If you don't write it down, or if you don't, it is already written. We have two angels here. They keep everything. Hafidheen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called them hafidh, keepers. Nothing will miss them, and they will not miss anything. So try to calculate your deeds and hold yourself accountable every night before you sleep. This will get you to the level of watchfulness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, يَسْتَخْفُونَ مِنَ النَّاسِ وَلَا يَسْتَخْفُونَ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَهُوَ مَعْهُمْ إِذْ يُبَيِّتُونَ مَا لَا يَرْضَى مِنْ قَوْلٍ. Some people, they are fearful of people, and they are not fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah is with them all the time. The problem is, because we don't see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in front of us, we are forgetful. We forget that He is already there subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we make the ma'asiyah or commit the sin, we don't see subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is there. Although He is there, but we don't see Him. So if our heart doesn't tell us that He is there, if our a'mal are good, we will stop and we'll do it. That's why Allah is saying they will be fearful of people and they are not fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Mulk, وَأَسِرُّوا قَوْلَكُمْ أَوِجْهَرُوا بِهِ إِنَّهُ عَلِيمٌ بِذَاتِ الصُّدُورِ. You say whatever you say it public or you say it secret, He subhanahu wa ta'ala is all aware of it. If you say it secretly, if you say it publicly, whatever way you say it, He subhanahu wa ta'ala knows it already before you say it. So we have to be very careful. And if we are watchful, what are the fruits of watchfulness? If we come close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we try to be watchful in our deeds, calculate everything, come close from Allah, what are the fruits? The first fruit is to be a good Muslim. To be good with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-adab ma'allah. Al-adab ma'allah means you have some etiquettes when you come to the salah, you are fearful, you are going to stay and stand in front of the King of the Kings, the Lord of the Lords, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you have some etiquettes for salah. So when you come to do something for fasting, you know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there and He's watching over you, and you have some etiquettes when you fast. When you give zakah, you have also some etiquettes when you give zakah or sadaqah. You don't give it to be proud of what you give and make yourself arrogant and tell everybody, I did this, I gave that. Alhamdulillah, I helped the masjid, I helped this, I did this. You give it just for Allah and with etiquettes. So adab, to have good etiquettes with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is one of the fruits of watchfulness. And also the best fruit that we are all looking for is Jannah. Jannah is the fruit of watchfulness. If we watch Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He subhanahu wa ta'ala will make this life Jannah for us, and inshallah we'll be in the Jannah, in the afterlife. And also one of the fruits is happiness, sa'ada. You will feel you are always happy with whatever coming on your way. Good or bad, it is the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you are pleased with that. And being pleased with whatever you have, this is a great ni'mah that is not given to everyone. It has to be acquired. It's not given. You have to work for that, to feel pleased with Allah, whatever He is giving you. This is a great ni'mah, and it's one of the outcomes of watchfulness, to be happy in which state you have. If you have money, you are feeling happy. If you don't have money, you feel the same. Or sometimes people, when they don't have, they feel more happier than the times they have, subhanAllah. Because they know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just testing them. So He subhanahu wa ta'ala is making it a little bit tight to see the iman, the level of iman. And then sooner or later it will come and will be bigger, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give His bounty subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you have to be pleased at all times. And also to be a sakina, tranquility. When you talk to people, you have this tranquility and serenity. And you are also modest, al-haya, and al-mahabba, to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and love everybody. Khushu' and khashya, when you come to the masjid, when you talk to people, you are submitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Raja' and tawakkul, hoping that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive everything and accept everything, and depending on Him subhanahu wa ta'ala and taking the means. All these are outcomes of watchfulness. Just before I close, I'll just mention a few short stories about the quality of watchfulness. The Salaf Ridwanullah alayhim, the Sahaba Ridwanullah alayhim, those are the ones who followed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as much as they could. That's why their names are shining in the books of Islam every single day since the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, and it will be still shining until Allah inherits this earth because of the watchfulness they had at that time. One of them is Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. We were just talking about Umar, like father, like son. And the apple does not fall away from the tree. We know Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu. Everybody knows Umar. His son Abdullah ibn Umar. And if you listen to Aisha radiallahu anha, Aisha, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wife, he said, if you want to see someone from the Sahaba who is very close from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he does every single thing the Prophet did, look at Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. Abdullah ibn Umar one day was going out with his companions, and in the middle of the way he stopped and he unmounted his horse and he took his horse and he just made a circle, and then he mounted his horse and he continued. And then the Sahaba radiallahu alaihim, his followers, said, Abdullah, what are you doing? We are traveling, and then suddenly you stopped at that place, and then you unmounted the horse, you made a circle, and then you continued. He said, I did this because I just saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam doing this at that place one day. I don't know why he did it, but I do it because I have seen him doing it. So this will give you an idea about how close Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu was with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then one day Urwa ibn Zubayr, he wants to marry his daughter, the daughter of Abdullah ibn Umar. Her name is Sauda. And Abdullah ibn Umar was making tawaf around the Kaaba. And Urwa ibn Zubayr was also making tawaf. So he saw Abdullah in the Kaaba, around the Kaaba. And then he is asking him, I am asking you to marry me, your daughter Sauda. So Abdullah ibn Umar didn't answer him. And then he went to Medina after that. So Urwa, when he reached the message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Medina, he found Abdullah ibn Umar there. And then when Abdullah ibn Umar saw Urwa, he said, Urwa came to him and again repeated, I wanted to marry your daughter Sauda. Abdullah said, I know, and I heard you when we were in Tawaf, but this is the time that he says, أَتَخَيَرُ اللَّهُ بَيْنَ عَيْنَيْهِ. This is the time when I was making tawaf that I imagined that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in front of me. And you are coming to me and asking me about this. So look at Abdullah is telling him, that time when I make tawaf, I imagine that I am in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and I see him and he's seeing me. And you come in tawaf and ask me about my daughter to marry her. So some of us have gone to Hajj, and some people go to Hajj and they make tawaf, and they have the cell phones, they talk to some people in Egypt, in Libya, in India, and sometimes they are laughing and they are arguing and they making business over the phone when they are making tawaf. Look at Abdullah, this is tawaf is ibadah. It is worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you make tawaf. And the man is asking him, his daughter, he didn't even answer him. And he waited until he finished that, and he's telling him, when I make tawaf, I imagine myself in front of Allah and I see him and he's seeing me. How come you come and ask me about anything from this dunya? So this is Abdullah ibn Umar. So he's watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also one day the same man, Abdullah ibn Umar, he was going out and he saw a shepherd who has sheep and goats and outside in the desert. And he said, let me buy one from you. And the man said, I don't own these sheep. And these are my masters. I am just a slave and I'm walking to him. Abdullah told him, I just give you the money, you give me the sheep, and you tell your master that the wolf has eaten the sheep. That's it. You tell him, I lost it, the wolf has eaten the sheep. And then the slave or the servant told him, if I tell him that, so what am I going to tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching over me. And if I tell my master, I lost one sheep, and he would say, okay, who will be pleading for me in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So Abdullah radiallahu anhu, he bought the whole flock of sheep, and he bought the servant, and he set him free, and he gave him all these sheep and cattle. This is also one of the watchfulness stories of Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. And all of us know Abdullah ibn Mubarak. Abdullah ibn Mubarak also name one of the big names in the Islamic books, Abdullah ibn Mubarak. His father name is Mubarak. And there was a man, his name is Nuh ibn Maryam. This man was very rich, very, very rich. And then he has his servant Mubarak working for him. And then one day he went to one of his gardens and he wants to eat some grapes. And he told Mubarak, his servant, please give me some grapes to eat. He is the master and he is very, very rich man. And he's asking his servant to get him a good grape or a good piece of grape to eat, the fruit to eat. And then he get him some and he ate it and he found it not very ripe. It's not good. He said, get me another one. So he got him another one for the second time. He ate, it wasn't good, it was sour, it wasn't sweet. Then the third time he asked him, he said, give me another one, these ones are not good. For the third time he got him a sour one, it's not good. So the man told him, you didn't even taste what you are getting me. You are getting me sour grape, it's bad. So Mubarak told him, I have been here many years serving in your gardens and I have never tasted one single grape. You can imagine servant who sometimes hungry, thirsty, he lives in the middle of fruits and vegetables and all these things, and he works for that man. If he ate, the man will not say anything, and he's telling him, I never ate one single piece of grapes because it's not mine. And then he told him, do you agree that I marry you, my daughter? You can imagine, like a king is offering his daughter to like a servant or a beggar in the street. And then he set him free and he married his daughter, the daughter of that rich man. And from their marriage came Abdullah ibn Mubarak, one of the biggest names in the history of Islam. So this is the fruit of watchfulness. And also Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu, will end with this story. We all know Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Al-A'zam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him and forgive him. His father wanted to, he was walking in the street and he stopped by a garden and he saw some fruits falling on the ground and he was hungry and he got one of the fruits and he ate it. And then after he ate it, he thought this is something for someone else. So he went to the garden and he found somebody working there and he asked him, can you please give me the permission to eat that? I ate some of that fruit and it's not mine. So the man told him, I just work here, I am a servant. This is not my garden. If you want to get the permission of the owner, he is like, you have to walk about a couple of days to reach his house. And that man, he walked a couple of days to go to the house of that man who owns the garden. And when he reached the house and he asked the man, I ate one of the fruits of your garden that fell on the ground. I just want to ask your permission because I don't want to eat anything haram. And then the man told him, I don't give you permission. I don't like what you do. I don't give you permission. So he was very mad. And he said, just one condition, I can give you permission if you marry my daughter. And she is blind, and she cannot hear, she cannot speak, and she cannot even walk. Look at this. A man going, walking for a couple of days to find the owner of the garden. He just ate one fruit, one single fruit, falling on the ground. And then when he reached there, the man is telling him, you have to marry my daughter. If you don't, I don't forgive you. I don't give you permission. And he said, immediately he said, yes, I will marry her. You will forgive me, I will marry her. And then he married her. And when on the first day of wedding, he got his wife. And then when he entered the room, he found her sitting. And then he said, she doesn't hear. She doesn't speak. She doesn't see. She cannot even walk. If I say Assalamu Alaikum, she doesn't hear me. How can she reply? So he said, I will just say Assalamu Alaikum. He said, Assalamu Alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. She said, Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So he was surprised. She is speaking. And she can see me. She is seeing me. And then she started walking towards him. He said, Subhanallah, why your father is telling me that you cannot see, you cannot hear, and you cannot even walk? She said, my father has spoken the truth. I cannot see anything haram. I cannot eat anything haram. I did not listen to anything haram. I didn't even go to anything or any place that is forbidden for me. That's why my father has told you these are my qualities. And from that man and this woman came Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah. The son of these two was Abu Hanifa al-Nu'man, the greatest imam ever who came to this world, and that's why they called him Al-Imam al-A'zam, the greatest imam, rahimahullah. He came from these two people. This man, he walked a couple of days because he ate one single fruit falling on the ground. So when he reached that man's house, this rich man is very smart. The man who is walking to your house for 2-3 days to ask your permission for single fruit, he is a very righteous man. That's why he is giving him his daughter to marry, because he knows he is giving his daughter to someone who will keep her in a very good hand. And finally, Al-Imam Abu Hanifa is the outcome of this marriage. So this is watchfulness. If we just keep talking about it, it will never end. But we as children, youth, adults, men and women, we have to watch our deeds. We have to calculate what we did, what we left. Did we do it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Did we leave it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make us, inshallah, happy in this life and in the afterlife. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among the ones who are watchful and the ones who watch Him subhanahu wa ta'ala in whatever they do, in whatever they leave. I ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our sins. I ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless our gathering. Allahumma ghafir lana ma qaddamna wa ma akharna wa ma asrana wa ma a'lanna wa ma anta a'lamu bihi minna. Anta al-muqaddim wa anta al-makhir wa anta ala kulli shayin qadir. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammadin nabiyil ummi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. Wa jazakumullahu khayran.